Dear researchers and all invited guests, it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the 5th International Conference on Information and Communication Technology for Competitive Strategies, digitally on Zoom. We all are going through a tough period to fight against COVID-19, and we are now in the second wave of this pandemic. The team of ICTCS 2020 wish you and your family to take necessary precautions. Be safe, stay healthy, and also overcome with this phase as well. We, Global Knowledge Research Foundation, are thankful to all our guests present on this digital platform to make this conference a success as the previous one. Hope you will enjoy this session. I would also like to highlight that all the presenters are given 8 minutes to complete their presentation. I request all presenters to stick on the specified time we allocate. Now, I would like to introduce our session chair, Dr. Paras Kothari. Hello, sir. He is a professor at Madhav University, Abu Road. He has a 23 year of teaching experience, and his primary research interests are in the area of planning, controlling, and development of an IT project. Welcome to you, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Our, now we will start our presentation. Our first presenter will be Vijaya Lakshmi Patil. Hello.
Yes, good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes.
Shall I share my screen, ma'am?
Sure.
Right. Good afternoon, one and all. I am Vijay Lakshmi, working as assistant professor in the Department of Information Science and Engineering, Dr. Ambedkar Institute of Technology, Bangalore. The co-author for the paper entitled Multi-Sync Routing Protocol for Underwater Sensor Networks is Anita Kanwali, professor and head of the Department of Computer Science Engineering, MS Ramaiah Institute of Technology, Bangalore. The paper ID of my presentation is 646. The contents of my presentation are introduction, related work, routing mechanism, results, conclusion, and references. Introduction. Underwater sensor network is a network whose main portion lies underwater. It mainly consists of underwater sensors, underwater sinks, surface sinks, and autonomous underwater vehicles, mainly to monitor the specific region. The main features of underwater sensor networks include the small bandwidth, high propagation delay, signal attenuation, mobile nodes, and higher error probability. The underwater sensor networks may be deployed as a one-dimensional, two-dimensional, or three-dimensional networks. The main applications of underwater sensor networks include the collection of oceanographic data, monitoring of presence of chemicals in water, the exploration of oil and gas, disaster detection and prevention, and the navigation assistance in the presence of rocks, underwater, etc., and tactical surveillance, tsunami and sea quake detection. The literature survey carried out in order to propose my work are these some of the routing protocols which researchers have already proposed. The first one among them is the vector-based forwarding routing protocol. So this routing protocol mainly uses the concept of vector pipe for routing the packets. The next routing protocol is hop-by-hop vector-based forwarding routing protocol. In this case, each node is having its own routing pipe. The third routing protocol is the neighbor information routing protocol. In this routing protocol, the weight of the neighbor node is used to select the next forwarding node. Similarly, the CRP protocol makes use of the connectivity index to decide the next forwarding node. And TCPIR is the cluster-based routing protocol. And this routing protocol uses the multi-sync architecture. And here the nodes are categorized as ordinary and courier nodes. The next protocol under study is a focused beam routing protocol. Here the transmitting node adjusts its power level of transmission, and only the nodes which are within the cone angle, they become the candidate nodes for the further transmission of the data. The next routing protocol is the directional flooding based routing protocol. It addresses the packet reliability and write problem. The depth-based routing protocol is mainly working based on the depth of the sensor from the surface level. It doesn't require any location information for forwarding. And the DSVBF is a VBF protocol wherein the two syncs are used. So the working principle is the same as the vector-based forwarding routing protocol, but it considers not only the location information, but also the residual energy to determine the route. The H2DAB is a hop-by-hop dynamic addressing-based routing protocol. In this, this also makes use of a multi-sync architecture. And here the addressing is done dynamically, and it decides which are the nodes belonging to a particular layer, and the nodes are directed towards the sink. The energy efficient depth-based routing protocol is also similar to DBR, but it concentrates on the energy consumption. So for forwarding the package to the next node, it considers the residual energy and also the depth information. The last protocol is the MRP, that is the multi-layer routing protocol. It makes use of the super nodes, which are having a very large energy, and these super nodes are deployed underwater, and they collect the information and they are routed to the onshore sinks. So this is the literature survey and my proposed work. I have proposed a routing mechanism, and mainly taking the issue of energy consumption. The major issue of madam, am I audible? Yeah. Yes,
audible.
So the major issue of the underwater sensor network is the energy consumption of the resources. The underwater sensors are mainly equipped with the batteries, and whenever the batteries are exhausted, we need to replace the battery, which is not very practicable. And therefore, the main issue we are addressing is to utilize the power of the sensors in the efficient manner, so that the energy efficient energy utilization leads to the increased network lifetime. So to bring the reduction in the energy consumption, I have proposed one network model as it is depicted here in the slide. The first, there are two scenarios which I have worked with. In the first scenario, the entire cubic volume of the water is divided into the different subcubes. And the the entire length and the breadth and the height of the water column is divided into the subcubes. And the first subcube is formed at a depth of D from the water surface. And the second cube is extending from the depth D to 2D. And the third water column is from D to 3D and so on.
Sorry to interrupt you, Vichya Lakshmi.
Yes, madam.
Yes, we have a time limit. So conclude your presentation within 1 minute.
Only 1 minute. Okay, thank you, madam. Okay, the scenario, these are the two scenarios. And here in the first scenario, there is only one sink. And in the second scenario, for every layer, I am having the sinks. multisync. So I have proposed the multisync architecture, and these are my simulation parameters. The nodes are deployed in the three-dimensional and in the 1 km³ range, and the energy model defined are for the initial energy of 50 ohms and transmission and receiving power etc. are as displayed here. And I have computed, I have got the results for average energy consumption, energy tax, average residual energy, the packet delivery ratio and throughput. So these are the scenarios which I have obtained for where the sink is on each layer, and all the parameters have been compared, and these are the comparison results of energy consumption and the energy tax and the average energy, and also the next three parameters have been compared for the both the scenarios, average and residual energy, packet delivery ratio and throughput, and also the residual energy has been obtained for each and every node of different sizes, 5, 10, 15 and 20. And these are the results obtained for the instant throughput. And these are the comparisons which are made for both the scenarios. So the conclusion of my research work is here I have proposed one multi-sync routing protocol for the underwater sensor networks. And the two scenarios, I have compared many performance matrices, and the comparisons shows that the percentage packet delivery ratio, there is an improvement for the network size of 10, 15 and 20. And the energy tax is also been improved for the 10 and 20 nodes. And so far the work has been carried out with the static single sync and static multi-sync architecture. As an extension of my research work, I want to implement the scenarios wherein there is a mobility for the sensor nodes as well as for the sync nodes. So these are the references. And
Hello.
Yeah.
Yes.
Do we have any question from the session? Other participants or the case?
No.
Okay. So there is one question which is from my side. As you said that in the underwater implementation, you have read. So when we are, the what are the sort of getting data for the oceanographic data? Hello, am I audible?
You are audible, but this is not clear. Could you please answer?
So, if we are considering the oceanographic data for the question of the energy thing when we are implementing this thing, so what are the sources from where we are getting the data for the analysis?
Sir, I have done the actual. It is not on the real test. Sir, it is only on the simulation. I used the simulator for this, and I have started the sensors have been deployed in the simulation. Wherein on the simulation scenario, I have just deployed start with 15, 16, 20 like that, and this is for the real test bed. I have to take the real time place. So only the simulations.
Have you shared the simulated result and data?
Pardon, sir. Pardon, sir.
Hello. Am I audible? Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
So, based on the simulation, when you design this, so have you shared those data somewhere for the further reference and use?
No, sir. This is my first paper of my research.
Okay.
And, actually my future work is on giving mobility to the skilled floor, sir, because here the improvement is not there is not much improvement with respect to the energy consumption. Now I am planning to give mobility to the sink floors and try my future.
Right. Okay, thank you. All the best. Good luck. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Vijayalakshmi, for your nice presentation.
Thank you.
Yes. Move to our next presenter, Deepa R.
Yes, ma'am. Shall I start sharing the screen?
Sure.
Give me a minute. I'm sharing the screen. Can you see my screen, ma'am?
Perfectly. Go ahead.
Yes. So good afternoon, one and all present here. I am Deepa from Chennai, Tamil Nadu, working in SRM Institute of Science and Technology as assistant professor, and I'm pursuing my part-time PhD as well. I'll begin my presentation by giving introduction, explaining about the introduction and purpose of my work, and I'll proceed go on with the hypothesis what I am following and started implementing and how the architecture I have constructed. And I finally give brief. I will brief on the result and what are all the extension of the work I have done. And I'll share this. Continue with the presentation. So the work is basically on blockchain, sidechain based data storage for reimagining the electronic healthcare using IFS system to optimize the complete data storage in electronic. Indian healthcare electronic healthcare record system. And coming to the introduction, so actually in the existing system in Indian healthcare, we have several stakeholders and information sharing between the stakeholders about the patient data is in, dependent on the network, and the flow of data is very difficult. And to provide solution to make to provide the optimal solution for this, I have taken blockchain technology as a solution, and which helps in healthcare system to optimize the flow, and which will provide the information, and we can make the information patient centric, where in case we can increase the accessibility of the data, which will provide the data availability. Also, meanwhile, we can provide the healthcare service to end all kinds of people available in India. And meanwhile, we can convert the manual maintenance of healthcare storage of data into a digital one. And the basic purpose of the work I have taken into consideration is to mainly develop and focusing on the conversion of healthcare data to provide the ownership with the patient using with the help of sidechain blockchain and with the help of the protocol IPFS. And the hypothesis which I have taken to provide the healthcare blockchain electronic healthcare record maintenance by creating smart contracts which holds the complete rules and which states the hashing information of the sidechain, where in case here which we call it as sidechain is nothing but the storage of individual patient's record in their own place, and the information will be the rules and regulation will be stored in the main block, that is basic blockchain, and in which we can achieve the information presence. We can decentralize the data availability. And in hypothesis two, I intend to reduce the burn of blockchain. Basically, blockchain is the technology which holds the hashed information, where in case I am dealing with healthcare data, where a lot different types of images and data documentation is required, where in case if we try to store all the information in blockchain, definitely the the feasibility and performance of the blockchain will be reduced, where in case I use this sidechain technology to answer for securing data as well to reduce the burden of blockchain. And then third hypothesis, which I have considered, where in case to transfer, blockchain is basically on providing data security and the transfer of data in easier manner. Where in case we use the sidechain, we have a question like how the data will be transferred, how the security can be maintained. So here in sidechain, where we transfer the data between sidechain to sidechain and sidechain to the main chain, we will be using the protocol called IPFS, where it is similar, which follows the similar technology of a blockchain, and it provides data security and faster transaction of data between the sidechains and sidechain to blockchain. And coming to implementation. So implementation, firstly, I have implemented the business logics of the system in case of smart contracts, where I have defined what are all the rules and regulations to be followed in the main blockchain. So in smart contracts, I have just make use of whatever the necessary functionalities to be provided as of now, like how migration can be done, how the patient can be get registered for record contracts, patient contracts, and migration contracts. I have basically defined three different smart contracts. And then I compiled and migrated the smart contract like before getting into blockchain. So I have tested the smart contract, and then I migrated those smart contract to the main blockchain. And the testing of smart contractors I have done in Truffle. And then I've created a user interface to interact with the user for getting information and from the patient to maintain the record. And finally, I have made interaction with the DApp in a browser for deploying the complete information, complete contract into a main blockchain. So here is my architecture. So in main blockchain, so all rules and hash information will be stored in main blockchain, where in case even before information storage, we have water node, where the water node will verify and store, make information to be get stored in the main blockchain. And as I told you, the necessary functionalities only I have added here. I included patient, provider, and third party. Where in third party, I can include the lab technicians, insurance providers. All I can include in place of third party. And sidechain, where it will hold the information about the own patients, and that too in the patients. And the data will be in control of patient. And where in case using technologies like blockchain, sidechain, and IPFS, so I have provided access control by making the entire data to be patient-centric. And with the help of protocol IPFS, the data security is provided eventually with in connection with blockchain, where a DApp Ethereum is used. And for faster accessing data, we have used sidechain and IPFS protocol here for achieving the faster accessing of data. And here comes the results. Truffle, we can make the patients register for the very first time, and we can create records, and we can include in the DApp using providing the address, Ethereum address, and whoever the doctor we need to consult. So that particular doctor's Ethereum address will also be provided, and we can create the record. And so even then, the information is available. The patient has to provide access to whoever the providers. If the data to be accessed, the patient has to provide access to the specific doctor and even whatever the third party inclusion or the lab technician or insurance guy we are including. So for them also, the patient has to provide the access rights. Like it could be either view or edit or whatever the access rights it can be provided, that is in hands of patient, because I have made the system as patient centric one. And it even can revoke the rights once the complete process is got over. And I have given a written contract for viewing the record from patient view as well as from the provider's view. And once the test is done in Truffle, so here we are. This is how the medical record can be added with the Ethereum block. And once the testing is done, the migration of the smart contract will be done to the actual blockchain, and then deployment happens. So actually, the deployment of the entire thing I have done in Ganesh, so where the payment is free till 100 ethers, and this is how I have implemented the entire system. About the originality of the work I have done. So here the entire control of the data is lying with the patients, and where in case data security can be provided with the help of methodologies used, both security and fast accessing of data can be done. And the plan of research extension I have is like I include IOMT, like to include an app, a developer app, and to provide the system available for all kinds of people, and also to increase the availability of the medical service to everyone. Whatever the document available as of now, as I told you, only necessary functionalities I've added for improvising the document, different types of document upload and interoperability availability should be increased. So that is my next research extension. And moreover, here I have used Ganache, and to move on to the Ethereum, we need to make payment for the blockchain, where in case I can include payment and improve the medical applications. And these are all my reference. And thank you for the opportunity provided.
Thank you, Deepa.
Yes. Thank you. Questions? Any questions, ma'am?
Is there any question from this one? Okay, thank you, Deepa.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, our next
one
is
Yashika. Once again, I'll stop sharing the screen.
I already stopped sharing.
Okay, thank you.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes, am I audible? Am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are in turn, please.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, one and all. So myself, Eshika. So now I'm going to present my work on the image fusion in multi-view videos under the SURF algorithm. So my co-author is Dr. Vinod B. Durge, and we are from Dhanan Sagar College of Engineering, Bangalore. And this is my content of my presentation. Coming on to the abstract of the paper, so the paper is basically on the stereo vision, and this is one of the emerging domain in the computer vision system where we are going to extract the information from the digital images. So for this, the implementation is done by using the SURF algorithm. This is one of the matching algorithm that has been used in the images. And for the fusing of the videos, we are going to consider the video that is captured under the parallactic condition, and the processing is done through the feature descriptor. The feature that is being present in the videos, we are using them for the processing of the two videos. So we are overall, we are combining the two videos, and this could be used for the object recognition purpose mainly. Coming on to the introduction, so the stereo reconstruction is always been one of the core problem in the computer vision system that is being used in the augmented realities and also in the robotics. So here the main concept of the implementation is the stereo reconstruction can be done, and also the depth can be computed by using the stereo pair images. And stereo vision is nothing but we are going to use the two cameras to capture the same scene over the two perspective views, similar to the parallax process that our eye uses to capture the reality world. So here the processing of the brain, how we are going to capture the two images or the two other object, basically when we are going to capture by using our eyes and process them, and it is been placed in one particular place. So the same thing is being done here. We are going to capture the videos and we are going to process them. And for this, we are going to use the stereo matching algorithm. And the stereo matching algorithm basically consists of the feature extraction, and we are going to match them, and the disparity estimation is done. Disparity is, we are going to, when the two images or two videos are overlapped, we can find that there is some difference that has been formed. So that the difference has been rectified by using our algorithm. So this is the stereo mechanism where we are going to use the two cameras to capture any scene or data. So by using the left camera and right camera, we are going to capture the object, and both the data set is being rectified by using the algorithm. And this slide explains about the multi-view videos. That is, we are going to combine the two videos that is capturing the same scene by using the image fusion techniques. Means by using the frames or the images that has been formed over the videos, we are going to combine them by using the algorithm. And this has been basically used in the intelligent robots for the sensing operators. Coming on to the literature survey. So the first paper is the base paper that is being used for analyzing of the frames. So this is basically the review of the paper is that this uses the error concealment techniques, and the error concealment technique, it depends upon the frame structures and the frame composition. And here they have been filled by using the DIBR technique. And the next one is the SIFT algorithm paper that is being given by the GIQ Liu. And here, this is the SIFT algorithm is one of the novel technique, but it is one of the basic stereo matching algorithm that uses the more computational when compared to the SURF. SURF is the second level improvement of the SIFT. And the third paper actually gave the idea of the SURF algorithm that is being used. And this paper also proves that many of the segmentational based algorithm is more the SURF is more being comparatively better when compared to the segmentation based algorithms. And by this paper we got the idea of the SURF for the implementation of the work. Coming on to the methodology, so here we are going to have the two camera inputs. So the camera inputs can be either in the image form or it could be in the data form. The extraction of the features is being done. Later, the matching of the two images or the two videos is being done by using the algorithm. And we are going to rectify them, and the disparity mapping is being done for the images. And finally, we are going to get the output. So coming on to the SURF algorithm. SURF stands for the Speeded Up Robust Feature. This is one of the interest point detection scheme that is being used for the objects for finding the specific points in the images. And this uses the integral images, and we are going to convolve the images here. For this, it uses the Hessian matrix as its basic derivative, where we can have the smoothing of the images by using the second order functions. And the procedure involved in the SURF algorithm is, first we are going to have the image integral image that is over the point descriptor. We are going to have the integral image, and the response map a different dimension. So in order to have over the same dimension, we need and have a many features that has been formed in the structures. So the interest point detection actually helps in finding out the interested points, that is the functions that is been required for the processing. And later, the orientation assignment is done for the data set. Orientation assignment is required because we need to have a scalable orientation for the comparable of the images or the videos that we are taking. And later, the descriptor extraction is been done because the required descriptors that is been needed for the procedure is much more interesting points that is needed for us. Hence, the descriptor extraction is done. Later, after finding of all the features and the extraction of the descriptors is done by the images, we'll match the images and rectify them. Finally, we are going to have the disparity mapping, and disparity mapping is nothing but it is we are going to find the corresponding points where we are going to have the difference when the two images are being superimposed over each other. So this is the results. So first, this is a Mulvery data set that is being taken. So here we are going to take the two images, left image and right image. So for the, we'll have the invariance over the illumination. So we are going to convert those images into the grayscale. And later, when we are going to composite two images, composite two images is we are going to overlap the two images. When the overlapping is done, we can find that there is some pixel difference that is being formed for the images. So for the analysis purpose, I have represented the left image by the right, and by the red color, and the cyan by the right image. So here the pixel difference we can find when the two images are being superimposed. So we need to rectify this actual difference that is being formed. For that, we are going to have the surf point detection. Surf point detection is the strongest points that we can have for matching them. So that is being done at the fourth step. At the fifth step, we are going to find the absolute difference over the points. And this is being done over the putating matching. That is nothing but the step where we are going to find the difference that is being formed over the images. And finally, by the absolute summing of the pixels, we are going to have the rectified image at the sixth step. And at the seventh step, the disparity mapping has been done. Disparity mapping actually helps in finding of the pixel difference, and also this can be used for finding of the object that is nearer to us and that is farther from that is nearer to us and object that are farther from us. That darker section of the images represents that the object are far from us, that is the background is when compared to the input or the rectified image. We can say that by the disparity mapping, the darker section says that the background is at the behind of the objects. So the same thing has been implemented in the video results where we have extracted the frames of the videos. So this is the AVI video that is been considered. So this is the left camera video that is captured. And this is the right camera video that has been captured. Overall, the two videos are being combined by using the same thing. So here we can see that there is some improvements that is being needed. So this is basically depends on the camera calibration. And also this can be rectified by using the deep learning technique that is being used for the future work. Coming on to the advantages. So when compared to SIFT or any other matching technique, SIRF algorithm is one of the convenient thing that could be understood and implement faster. And also the photo geometric condition of the images or data set could be handled very much easier when compared to the other algorithms. And the next is the applications. So this can be used in the image registration techniques. Also this can be used in many of the medical fields and mainly in the robotic applications in the sensing and tracking, this can be used. And coming on to the conclusion, so this is one of the feature-based image fusion technique that is being used. And for the implementation, I have used the MATLAB software as it is user-friendly and provides us the interactive environment for the implementation. And this is one of the intrinsic parameters of the videos that can be used for finding of the rectified video by overcoming the correspondence problem. And finally, we can have the reduced mismatched points comparatively when it is used. So these are the references that is being used for the implementation. And thank you.
Thank you, Yashika. Do you have any query regarding the question? See, okay, over to you.
Okay, thank you. Yes, our next presenter, Kaneez Zainab.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now you can start your presentation.
Ma'am, actually, it's asking to close the previous presentation.
Done. It's already done. Now you can. You have all rights to share your screen.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, visible.
Yes. Good afternoon, everyone. My topic for the presentation is analysis of various existing algorithms used for detection of fraudulent credit card transactions. I'm Kaneez Zainab, presenting my paper. My co-authors are Dr. Namrata Dhanda and Dr. Kamar Abbas. The agenda or the content of this paper presentation is introduction, objective, challenges, related work, and comparison of various boosting algorithms. As we all know that due to the rapidly growing online market, which results in online mode of payment, due to which we can see there is a sharp rise in fraudulent credit card transaction. Now, this is a matter of great concern because we can see that due to this, it leads to financial loss, which obviously is a matter of concern. So credit card fraud transaction is being one of the considerable targets by the hackers these days. Credit cards can be classified as physical credit and virtual. For physical credit card, the customer has to provide the details at the time of payment. This basically leads to the stealing of the card by the hacker to access the data. While in the virtual one, the fraudster actually accesses the customers through various methods. Now this one is more prone to attack. In this world of digitization, many illiterate people or many people are basically unaware of the technology, thus resulting to the victims of fraudulent attack. Hence, it has become a necessity to develop an efficient fraud detection system or model that is basically very productive and efficient enough to enhance the accuracy and also develop the technologies that could prevent the fraudulent attacks happening. There have been various studies conducted using artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning, which are highly in demand these days. Machine learning, which are using classification and regression model, is one of the most productive methods which is being used for the detection of fraud. Machine learning algorithms that are being used are traditional machine learning algorithms. For example, we can say decision trees, artificial neural network, support vector machine. When analyzing and studying the traditional machine learning models like logistic regression, decision trees, naive bias, classification model, it was identified that they were not basically appropriate to provide the highest accuracy, and they cannot basically solve the key challenges, that is the skewness of data, that is the profile of the constant changing of the profile of fraudulent and non-fraudulent transaction. So a classifier combination, we can say that ensemble technique was an active field of research. So in this review paper, basically the objective of this review paper is due to this new advances in e-commerce that has made the credit card easiest mode of payment, showing steep rise in fraudulent transaction. The basic contribution of this paper is the focus on ensemble technique that combines various weak learners, or we can say various individual or single model to enhance the stability, resulting in better prediction, and that's than the individual learning model. this paper basically analyzes the standard models of machine learning, and then boosting algorithms are analyzed to find out perform are more accurately and precisely to predict fraudulent transaction. On identifying them, we can see that the different boosting algorithms like ADA boost, gradient boosting, extreme gradient boosting, light gradient boosting, we can see that these models which are using basically ensemble technique, we can see that the results that are predicted are more accurate, and the model is more efficient than the if we are using traditional algorithms. So the challenges which these boosting algorithms which these boosting algorithms are used to solve is a data imbalance, that is a very less count of when we are analyzing, we can see that there are very less count of fraudulent transaction as compared to genuine one. Skewness of data is the second key challenge. That means skewness means that the constant changing of the profile of fraudulent and non-fraudulent transaction. Third key, challenge was feature selection, that is how to appropriately select the data so that the key values are not missing. In my related work, we could see that basically there are two methods which are being used, that is two techniques which are being used. It is learning, supervised learning, and the second technique is unsupervised learning. Machine learning algorithm basically use supervised learning. Why? Because it examines all historical data and label them as legitimate and fraudulent. On the other hand, the unsupervised learning algorithm basically directly learns from the patterns of the credit card transaction so that the data can be categorized as genuine, and the data which do not conform to the trends that are categorized as fraudulent data. So supervised learning are basically more efficient in these popular algorithms. There are some of the work. For example, in this paper, Sahil Dankant in his work observed that extreme gradient, also known as XG boosting, outperforms all other algorithms using data set from credit cards in the comparative study. He further analyzed that the finest model according to the performance metric are random forest. Random forest again is using bagging technique. It is again one of the ensemble technique, gradient boosting, and the ensemble model that can be customized when comparing different algorithms on real data set. The reason of underperformance of these algorithms were also the unbalanced data. In second paper, Yasil Kant and A. Barim in his paper investigated a gradient boosting technique model for different attributes, and the author in this paper used real-time data set of transaction for various attributes that included categorical, numerical, and textual attributes. A study was made on combining these attributes. Basically, feature engineering was used, and it could be observed that gradient boosting trees, that is GBT, is a shows better result as compared to this normal traditional algorithm, traditional machine learning algorithms. In this next paper, Amal Ajari in this proposed work explored that the various working of single classifiers also administered the performance by uniting the single models using ensemble technique on credit card data set. Here also the work presented is by he first took the data set, and then he used normal traditional algorithm like decision trees, naive bias, and a support vector machine. Then after that, on the same data, he used this ensemble technique, and then he observed that the performance metrics such as accuracy, F1 score, and ROC value showed better results if we are using this ensemble technique or boosting techniques. These are some of the analysis of the boosting algorithms. In the first paper titled Application of Credit Card Fraud Detection Using Bagging Ensemble Model, here the technique which is used is supervised learning. In the method which is used is bagging classifier, and the result shows that accuracy is improved. It can also handle imbalanced data set, and bagging classifiers take less time. Second paper on analysis, of horse race analysis and credit card fraud detection using deep learning, logistic regression, and gradient boosting technique. Again, the learning technique is supervised learning, and the method shows that comparing logistic regression, gradient boosting, and deep learning based on the predictive power, it can be observed that deep learning method shows better result. And here the author also used feature engineering, which is again one of the key challenge in the data. The third paper titled Credit Card Fraud Detection Using AdaBoost and Majority Voting, it again used supervised learning. Here the author used ensemble learning model. In this, he used adaptive boosting along with majority voting. Real card credit card data set was used, and it can be observed that AdaBoost algorithm performs better if we are comparing on the performance measures such as ROC, accuracy, and F1 score. Again, the fourth paper titled Credit Card Fraud Detection Performance Improved Using Advanced Super
Gradient. Sorry to interrupt you, Kani.
Yes, ma'am.
Please conclude your presentation.
Yes. So these were some of the algorithms which used boosting algorithm techniques, and and the result shows that these algorithms provide better results if we are using single models, and these ensemble technique give better results. So it can be concluded that this for my paper, I can conclude that this paper basically focuses on studying of machine learning algorithms using ensemble models. It can be observed that if we want to develop an effective and effective fraud detection model, then it can be seen that if we are using ensemble learning technique, then that results provide better results. So the future scope of my work is to basically, this was a review paper, so the future scope will be to implement this fraud detection model using ensemble technique, and we can also handle the key challenges, for example, data imbalance and feature engineering, these and the skewness of data, which is basically the key challenge of the data. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Zainab. Is there any question there? A small doubt was there, Zainab. I wanted to ask that whether this analysis will equally good for UPI-based transactions fraud also? Or do we need some changes in this model for that?
We'll be needing some changes for if we are considering the UPI data also, because actually that will be real time data set, so there will be some changes if we are using it.
And do you consider this thing in your for future presentation?
Yes sir, this will be my objective also.
In that case, you can make this ML-based model for both of the transactions, like credit card and UPI, because in e-commerce in these days, maximum transactions are done by these two ways.
Right? Yes, yes, yes.
By the credit card or by the UPI.
Yes, sir. UPI. Yes, sir. I'll be taking that UPI thing also.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All the best.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kanish, for your presentation. Nice presentation. Yes. Move to our next presenter, Mr. Vishal.
Am I audible, madam?
Yes.
Audible. Okay, I'm sharing my screen.
Sure.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Yes, please.
Okay. So myself, Vishal Narwani. I'm working at GLS University, Ahmedabad, Gujarat. And my co-author is Harshal Arolkar. My today's topic is study of text-to-speech conversion for Indic languages. So this is going to be my agenda today. Introduction to text-to-speech technology, text-to-speech conversion, various methods for text-to-speech conversions. Apart from that, we have compared various Indic TTS. Text-to-speech technology. Now, when we look around this world, we can observe human being as the most powerful creature. Human has various capabilities like imagination, storage capability, intelligence. So most of the research in computer science aims at making a computer as powerful as human being. And apart from all this, speech is the most common form of communication among individuals. And since last few decades, researchers are trying hard so that computer can speak like a human being. And apart from that, it is used extensively in various assistive technology, suppose visually challenged people want to read something, then text-to-speech technology can help them. So if I talk about TTS conversion, text-to-speech conversion, there are basically two steps. First is we'll need to process the text. Suppose if I want to input the text 1, 2, 3, 4 to computer. So first of all, I'll need to convert 1, 2, 3, 4 digit to equivalent text. That is O-N-E, T-W-O, T-H-R-E-E, and F-O-U-R. So this is one of the example of text processing. Apart from this, there are various steps which needs to be done before computer can speak it. And another is speech synthesis. So speech synthesis, what it does, it generates a waveform according to text. Now, if I, in text-to-speech system or speech synthesizer software, it can be developed using three ways. There are three various principles on which TTS conversions can be made. First is concatenation synthesis, second is pure synthesis, and third is neural network based synthesis. So concatenation synthesis is widely used and you will find so many research work on concatenation synthesis. What it actually does, it words are divided into equivalent phonemes, human spoken phonemes, and human spoken phonemes are stored in a database. So when text is processed, suppose text is, hello, how are you? So what it will do, it will find equivalent phoneme to text, and then it will apply concatenation as per the language rules, and it will generate one WAV file. Second one is pure synthesis. The advantage of pure synthesis over concatenation is it doesn't store any WAV files or any human spoken words. Machine generates robotic voice based on various parameters like frequency, channel, sample rate, amplitude, duration, and combining all these features, robotic or machine voice is generated. Third one is neural network based synthesis. In this, neural network, like we have multiple neural networks, models like WebNet, Tekotron, Deep Voice, and Festival. So neural network is trained based on human speech, and apart from that, this text will be processed. That processed text will be passed to neural network, and then trained data from the trained data, equivalent speech will be generated. We have analyzed various TTS which are developed till date for Indian languages like Hindi, Gujarati, Tamil, Punjabi, and we have analyzed their work, and what are they storing, on the basis of which tool or framework they have developed the TTS. So first one, a simultaneous text-to-speech conversion system. They have used inbuilt Google text-to-speech library synthesizer provided by Google. They have developed mobile-based Android application. Second one is they have worked on Hindi language, and they have used concatenation approach. They have also developed one Android-based mobile application. Third one is developed in Gujarati. They have again used concatenation, and they have used pre-recorded Gujarati phonemes. They have developed that tool in Microsoft Visual Studio using C# and SQL. Fourth one is in Hindi. Same way, they have developed their concatenation approach using Java Swing. Next is Malayalam text-to-speech. They have used Partnum database. Now, Partnum database is a when we want to merge two phonemes, then the gap between these phonemes, they have used that also, and they have used PSOLA, which is a tool. Next is Marathi. They have used neural network based TTS conversion, plus they have used concatenation. and they have stored DIFON database, the widely used TTS engine, that is Festival TTS engine. Festival is a open source text-to-speech tool which provides various languages through which TTS can be developed. So they have used this Festival. Next one is again in Gujarati. They have developed this tool in MATLAB using Gujarati phoneme database. Again, next is in Punjabi. They have used Punjabi speech database, and again they have applied concatenation approach. And last one is using, they have developed Gujarati TTS using Festival framework for Gujarati language. So if I conclude, majority of the researchers are using concatenation approach for building their TTS, but this technique has various disadvantages, like we'll need to store various speech phonemes into system, so it will need large memory space. A resultant speech may sound emotionless and less natural. And our observation is that in Gujarati language, TTS development of TTS is done, but not to that extent. So we have decided that we'll be working on Gujarati TTS, and you will be using neural network based approach for our research work. These are my references.
Thank you, Vishal.
Yes.
Is the question from the session? Vishal, which other languages you are looking for along with Gujarati?
No, I am basically looking for, yes, Gujarati language. But if I successfully work on Gujarati language, then implementation of other languages will be quite easy. But my primary goal is to develop Gujarati TTS for TTS for Gujarati language only.
For other languages like Malayalam, Malgu and other?
Yes, we can do that. If I successfully implement my model in Gujarati language, then just by changing the data set and some language rules, that model can be used for other languages also.
So we have the technical support and presentation and the rules which we need to change it.
I'm not able to hear you.
I'm sorry. Is it audible? Clear?
Yes, sir.
Now it is audible.
So what I see, we have the tools and rules for the. Hello.
Hi. Yes.
The data set and rules. I'm talking about the in data set and rules of the.
So we haven't started yet working on implementation, and just this is my first research paper. And we have just analyzed the work which is done in.
So what are your future plans for that?
My future plans are.
In that case, you can tell me the future.
So we will be using, as I discussed, there are three approaches. So we will be using neural network based approach, in which we will be implementing the TTS. Neural network based approach that we are going to follow.
Okay, thank you, Vishal. All the best.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Vishal, for your nice presentation.
Thank you.
Now we are done with. With our all participants for being a part of this international conference. All the presenters will be getting their digital certificates, payment receipts, and thank you letters through email within 2 working days. And further, all the papers have already been forwarded to the Springer to publication process.
and the publication will be live within 4 to 5 months. Kindly cooperate with the ICTCS 2020. Thank you for your all participants. And again, I thank our present chair, Dr. Paras Kothari. Thank you, sir, for chairing this session.
Thank you for your valuable presence, sir.
Here is small token for your chairing this session. Wait 2 minutes, sir. This is a small token from our site. Digital certificate for you.
Thank you very much. I hope I will get this in my mail. And thank you for being this part of this CTCS 2020. And thanks and regards to the team. Thank you.
Wait a minute, sir. Can you open our camera for a quick snapshot for memories of ICTCS 2020?
Yes. I think am I visible there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, visible. Okay. All other participants can open your camera, please. A smile, please. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe, stay healthy. We can get through this together. Take care.
Thank you. Thank you. Take care, everyone.